In this hands-on lesson, we're going to work with Amazon SQS queues. We're going to create a standard queue and a FIFO queue, and we're going to have a look at the various options and how the different types of queue actually work. So I'm in the Amazon Simple Queue Service console here, and we have actually used this earlier in the course. We did create a couple of queues for previous hands-on lessons, but this time we'll go into lots more detail. So let's create a queue. Now, the first queue I'm going to create is a standard queue. So you see I can choose here between standard and FIFO. I'll just call this one my STD queue so I can recognize it as being my standard queue. Now, you'll note some of the various configuration options here. So we've been through these in the theory lessons. We have the visibility timeout. We have the delivery day. We have the receive message wait time, the message retention period, and the max message size. So the visibility timeout, as you know, is the period of time in which once you've actually received the message, you have that time to process it and it will be invisible in the queue. After that expires, it becomes visible again and can be processed by another consumer. So that can be between 0 and 12 hours. The delivery day gives your consumers a bit more time before new messages will appear in the queue, so they don't actually appear in the queue immediately. And you can specify a time period between 0 seconds and 15 minutes. The receive message wait time is the period of time that polling will actually wait for messages to appear in the queue. And we're going to look at how we can work with different times on that a bit later on in this lesson. Then we have the message retention period. So how long do they stay in the queue? That's 1 minute up to 14 days. And the max message size is between 1 kilobyte and 256 kilobyte. All stuff that does get tested on in the exam. Now we have a resource-based access policy. I'm not going to change anything here, but you can see the default settings. So we have the basic option defined. It says, who can send messages? Well, only the queue owner. Who can receive messages? Only the queue owner. And you can see in here, we then have the effect allow. We have the AWS account number, and then we have SQS star, so all API actions associated with SQS. And then we have the actual ARN of this specific queue. We'll cover redrive policy a bit later on. So that's where we can specify a dead letter queue. For encryption, SQS does provide encryption in transit by default, but then you can add at-rest encryption here. So I'll leave that disabled for now. Dead letter queues will come to you soon, and tags are just tags. So let's create this queue. Great, so now I have one queue. Let's go back. We're now going to create another queue, and this one will be a FIFO queue. So it's going to support first in, first out delivery. I'm going to call this my FIFO-queue dot FIFO. So note that it has the dot FIFO extension to it. Now, much of this is the same, but as you can see, there are some different options here. We have this content-based deduplication. When this is enabled, the deduplication ID is optional. We'll leave that off. You can enable high throughput FIFO, or you can leave that disabled. There's then a scope for deduplication, and that's either at the queue level or at the message group level. We'll change it to message group to experiment. We then have a throughput limit, that's per queue or per message group ID. I'll leave that as the default setting. And that's it, I'm not going to change anything else. Let's just create this queue. So now we have our two queues. Let's go into the first queue, and what we're going to do is send a message. So we click on send and receive messages here. We can just type something in and send this message. So now what we can do is poll for messages and we'll see that the message appears. And when we actually poll for messages, the receive count goes up to 1. So it has actually been received. We're essentially initiating a receive message API action. Now, if we head over to the FIFO queue, so let's choose my FIFO queue. And we're going to do the same. We're going to send and receive messages. And now I'm going to type in test message again. I'm going to give it a group ID. Let's call that group 1. And let's give it a deduplication ID. And that's just going to be 123456. And let's send that message. So now let's send another message. It's also going to be in group 1. And it's also going to have the same deduplication ID. So let's send that message. And then let's poll for messages in the queue. Now, as you can see, there's only one message. And that's because we did turn on that deduplication at the group level. So if I change the group here to group 2, send message, now I have another message in the queue. And of course, if I change this number, so I just add something onto it and send, and now I should get an additional message. Sometimes you have to stop and start. And now we have additional messages. So we have those three messages. So that's the difference. So with the message group ID, we can deduplicate the messages that are sent. So if two messages have the same deduplication ID and they're in the same group, if you're using group-based deduplication, then they will be deduplicated. So the extra message will be removed. If you do it at the queue level, then it's going to focus at the queue level rather than the group level. And of course, it's up to you to create your application to actually add in the deduplication IDs to support your use case. I'm going to create another queue, and this is going to be a dead letter queue. It's going to be a standard queue called MyDLQ. Under redrive policy, we can identify which source queues can use this queue as a dead letter queue. So let's click on enabled. I can sort by queue, so I can filter and only allow messages to be moved into this queue from my standard queue. So that's fine. I'm going to do that. Click on create queue. Let's go to my standard queue, choose dead letter queue, edit, and then we scroll down to where it says dead letter queue, select enabled, and then we're going to find our dead letter queue. There it is, my DLQ. And for maximum retries, I'm going to put 3. And that means we'll only be able to retry processing of a message a maximum of 3 times. So let's save that. And what we're going to do now is click on send and receive messages. We're just going to try and send a test message. Let's send the message. And now we're going to poll for messages, and our receive count will go to 1 for this message. Let's stop polling, poll again, receive count goes up. Let's do it a third time. So now we have 3 receives. One of the messages that was already in our queue seems to have disappeared. And let's just do it one more time. And now we should find that both messages disappear from the queue because we exceed that redrive. So if we now go back up to queues, choose my DLQ, and let's click on send and receive messages, poll. And now you can see that we have these two messages. So because we exceeded that value of 3 for the maximum number of retries, the messages that weren't processed were then pushed into the dead letter queue. So now we can do something else with them to check what went wrong. We're now going to run a few commands so we can work with the CLI. So in your code directory from the course download, you've got Amazon SQS and then AWS SQS CLI commands. Now the first one is simply AWS SQS list queues. And that will help us get our queue URL. So if I paste that in, it will return the URLs of our different queues. Now, I want to choose this one here so I can copy that to my clipboard. Now, I've already entered that in here, but if you might need to come in and paste in your queue URL. Now, I'm not going to use all of this. I'm going to leave off this delay seconds. So what I'm going to do is copy this to my clipboard. And back on the command line, I'm going to paste that in. Now, before we get started, let's go to SQS and we're going to start polling for messages. So back in SQS, I'm going to go back up to queues, choose my standard queue. I'm going to click on send and receive messages and then poll. And of course, there's nothing there yet. So now I'm going to run this command, come back, and straight away, I see that message. So that's coming through instantly. And that's because we didn't add a delay seconds. For the next command, we're simply going to put in dash dash delay dash seconds, and we're going to give it a parameter. So that's going to be 10 in this case. Now just make sure that you're still polling. In this case, I'm going to stop polling, poll again. We've still got our message from before. Come back, let's hit enter. And back in the queue, what we should find is within a few seconds, we have a new message come through. And there it is, there's our new message. So that's what the delay seconds does. For the next test, what we're going to do is we're going to test using the wait time seconds. So this is the difference between long polling and short polling. Now I need to remove these messages now before our next test. So let's delete these messages. So now we have an empty queue. And what we're going to do is practice with the wait time seconds. So this controls the behavior of polling. So short polling or long polling. Now with a zero here, that's going to be short polling. So let's copy this to our clipboards. Now we know there's nothing in the queue. So let's go over and paste this into a command line. And we have two command lines side by side here. You'll see why in a moment. But first, I'm going to try using wait time second zero. And what happens is the API action checks if there's a message. There weren't any messages in the queue, so it just immediately stops. Okay, so that's cost us now a couple of API actions. So there are charges associated with that. So what we want to do instead is use long polling. So with long polling, what I'm going to do is I'm going to change this. So let's change this one to 10 seconds. And I'm going to copy that, paste that in. I'm not going to run it just yet. And then we're going to copy this command here. So we have a receive message and we have a send message. So let's copy the send message. And the send is going to go from the right window. So what we can do here is I'm going to run this and it should wait for up to 10 seconds. So you can see it's waiting now, nothing's happening. Now, if I run this command, straight away we see a response. So what's happened is I've used the send message API to send a message into the queue from this right-hand window. And in the left window here, we already had long polling enabled and we were waiting for messages to appear in the queue. So that's how long polling works. So back in my queues here, we finished for this particular lesson. Now I'm going to keep the my standard queue. We're going to use that in another lesson, but we can actually delete the other two queues. So I'm going to delete my FIFO queue and my DL queue. And those are gone. And that's it for this lesson. I'll see you in the next one.